Welcome. Employment around the world seems to be in transition. Some say jobs are likely to be lost. Others feel that new opportunities for employment are emerging. The Middle East is very important for overseas workers, and Indians form a large part of the workforce there. So where is the Middle East heading when it comes to overseas workers and employment? My guest today is Michael Al-Nassir, who's a partner in the global executive search firm Pedersen Partners and heads Middle East, Africa, South and Central Asia. Welcome, Michael.
Thank you, Victor.
The Middle East job market is where many eyes are now focused. Some say that the jobs are drying up because of the economic situation there and also the oil prices that have come to an all-time low. Others say that, in fact, there is a shortage of employees after what people are now calling the human resources flight. So, in your opinion, what is really happening there?
Well, I believe that the real picture is still probably difficult to capture because this is in progress. It is true that we have seen some job losses among organizations in the Middle East, particularly in the Gulf countries. And I would say some of the most hit have been, of course, the travel industry, hospitality, food and beverages, consumer goods. So there is definitely has been a drop, and there are signals that people are leaving some of the countries in the region, be it Saudi Arabia or the UAE, at all levels. So from senior management to blue collar. However, this is not across the board. Some organizations have chosen not to cut jobs, but rather to reduce salaries in order to preserve employment and effectively prepare to the end of the COVID restrictions. Also, we may see some new jobs being created that are different and that emphasize today's requirement to focus on new methods of supply chain, e-commerce, and effectively some of the new types of businesses that have emerged even during the lockdown.
But do you think this creation of new jobs will offset the loss of the old traditional jobs? Or do you think that this will be a very small increment and the old jobs would likely suffer but probably come back in some time?
I think it will be a small increment. I don't think it will be a like-for-like replacement. And also, I think it will happen gradually over time. It will not be something very rapid. I think we have history to look at. 2008, 2009, the global financial crisis, of course, hit the Gulf region very hard. We also saw an exodus of foreign nationals who worked in the Gulf region, a very strong exodus. And of course, the naysayers at the time were saying, you know, that that this will not be replaced by new people coming to the region in the future. The contrary has been seen, and you know, over 2010, 11, and 12, gradually, not just Dubai but the rest of the GCC replenished those foreign workforces, be it blue collar, middle management, senior management. Albeit with some changes and maybe also focusing on different origins. So I would say that there are more middle management positions filled by South Asians in the Middle East than there were in the past, replacing more expensive Western expats, for example.
So if you were to do some crystal ball gazing, where do you see this go in the next 1 year? When I'm talking of crystal ball gazing, I mean, of course, putting it in perspective with your experience, where do you see the jobs move in regions that are likely to benefit, and also the areas where you think jobs will be created?
Well, I think it very much depends on how fast the countries will emerge from their respective lockdowns or you know, effectively security situations. Overall, I would say that some of the countries that were well prepared, and the UAE is one of them, are starting to emerge now and opening trade, encouraging, for example, the F&B trade, the retail trade, and the consumer trade to open up fully, still with some restrictions in terms of capacity use. And this is obviously, you know, in balance while trying to maintain a secure environment, but at the same time trying to balance with encouraging trade to continue. Some of the countries in the region are still struggling with a higher number of cases and thus are not releasing the lockdown. So I would say that the better the countries are prepared, the sooner they will emerge. Crystal balls are notoriously inaccurate, but I would say that the UAE, as it emerged after the global financial crisis, is one of the countries that will emerge quite strong. I would say that Saudi Arabia, because it is obviously one of the largest in the region by population, is likely to also emerge to fill the need to produce and to do trade. And then some of the other smaller countries in the region may lag behind a little bit, but simply because they do not have the same infrastructure and are not necessarily as well prepared for a crisis like this.
How do you see salaries move? Do you think there will be a downward trend into the future? Or do you think that with more opportunities in some sectors and less people to take them up, perhaps salaries will move upward?
Look, I think, again, referring back to the GFC, you know, salaries may have dropped temporarily and then started to rise again. So, you know, I think due to things like inflation and exchange rates, salaries never drop for long, even during a crisis, and tend to reestablish themselves. What happened 10 years ago and what is happening now is that companies are obviously seeking to save costs by doing temporary salary reductions. Those are not by any means permanent, you know, generally the employer is assuring the employee that at the end of the crisis, the salaries will be returned to their original levels. Where I do think companies will be saving is that with the current pressure in terms of you know, financial circulation, and availability of money by the consumer, is that they will be saving money on rents, which are generally paid by the consumer in some of the countries in the Middle East. They'll be saving money on items like schooling, where I see some costs dropping. So effectively, while the cash salary component may not drop long term, some of the additional components or benefits may see a drop, so the total salary bill may drop a little bit, but I don't see a significant reduction, you know, once we are out of the crisis.
Do you see a change now in the requirements that employers are giving you with regard to skill sets that they're looking for, especially in the middle and top level management? Are they looking now more at crisis management and perhaps stronger financial acumen in employment? Is that how you see it?
Yeah, I think that's a very good question. And we have seen some of that on some of the projects we are working on in senior leadership. There is a stronger emphasis on people who are able to manage through crisis. So effectively, you know, if somebody has already been in a leadership position during the GFC or even prior to that and have experienced situations where they needed to adapt to more difficult markets, that skill set is very valuable. Younger leaders, and we've seen that again 10 years ago during the GFC, you know, younger leaders who grew on the wave of success and the wave of growth were not necessarily equipped, and that is not a criticism, that is just a question of experience, were not necessarily equipped with the skill set to be able to adapt rapidly to the changing environment. So I think people today who can keep a calm and composed attitude, leaders who can inspire people around them to be cautiously optimistic, and I call it bounded optimism, And people who can maintain, you know, strong leadership during these times will succeed better than those who succumb to the pressure or maybe have a more negative outlook. And obviously also be able to make decisions rapidly is a very important factor today. We have seen situations where effectively companies, leaders freeze, deferring decisions into the future because of uncertainty. The contrary is required. It is required to make a decision now and rapidly, whether it is to change the business model, to cut costs, to close offices, or on the other hand, look for other revenue sources. It is important to make decisions rapidly and effectively, and if necessary, adapt them as we go along, as opposed to not making decisions.
And how much of a change has taken place with working from home? Do you think this will hit the property market for, let's say, real estate in the commercial area? Or is it not really going to have much of an impact in the long run?
I think that's a very complex question and difficult to answer. I will first of all address the effect of working from home. Obviously, not all jobs can be done from home. So we're talking about generally jobs that are commercially related, financial management, desk jobs, effectively. We are not talking about, obviously, jobs in production, factory floor, and so on, just to be very precise. I think that adapting to working from home has been easier in some of the, I would say, more intellectual professions. So effectively, advisory services, technology services, and so on, were already probably adapted to working remotely, not necessarily from home, but remotely. And the step from working remotely to working from home is quite easy. What has been an issue that has come up in conversations with leadership in the region, not only in the region, but globally, is that seemingly people's calendars filled up, sometimes even more than when they were working from offices. And this caused, on occasion, caused stress and overwork, because, of course, the type of gaps that we would have naturally in our calendars, the short respite afforded by the taxi ride or the commute to a meeting, which allowed you to sort of breathe and change environment, suddenly disappears, and people are stepping from one video call or a telephone call to another. So it's very important to have you know, some level of discipline and impose maybe breaks, you know, be it a lunch break or a coffee break in the middle of the day. But generally, I have heard people say that they are busier than they were ever before. Now, how will this affect us into the future? I think that for some professions, it may be desirable to continue encouraging people to work remotely. Again, not just talking from home, but talk remotely. This might mean that for some positions, we might not need to relocate people, but have them work from the country of origin. So obviously that would effectively save costs in terms of not only office, but housing. But I don't believe that this will be a mass change. I believe that certainly when it comes to leadership, be it middle leadership or senior leadership, the importance of the personal contact, the teamwork where people gather together to work in teams, to work in team environments, I think is very valuable, not only for the creative aspect and not only for the decision-making aspect, but also for the psyche. I think people are naturally gregarious and will do better when working in team environments as opposed to isolated. So there might be a small drop in cost. There might be some professions which encourage people to work remotely more than before, but I don't believe it will be a major global change.
Another change that has been happening for quite some time in the Middle East is that countries have been wanting to retain jobs for their own population. So they've been wanting to cut overseas employment and try and retain or, as they say, indigenize the industry and the jobs. Do you think this particular scenario today will be a shot in the arm for those programs that some of the countries are running?
Well, in practice, maybe not a shot in the arm, but certainly encouragement and proof that if you can localize your workforce at many levels, it is a long-term benefit because of probably longer tenure, less need to change the person, the employee, because they would not repatriate, maybe even a cost element. But you have to always bear in mind that it all starts with the availability and the supply of the talent. So the fact that a gap is created doesn't mean that there is automatically availability. What many of the countries in this region and the UAE and Saudi Arabia are very much at the forefront have done is obviously to encourage further education, be it in country or abroad, encourage further education, encourage training, and impose quotas for local nationals to be in certain positions. And so obviously, you know, gradually increasing those quotas. So I think that is the right thing to do. And countries have been following that model. But if you cannot have the talent required available at this time, you will still need to replace them with foreign nationals.
And how do you see the future? Are you optimistic about a quicker recovery now?
That's a question I think that everybody is asking themselves. And you know, it's important to look all over the world. We see some countries opening up faster than others, and that's including in Asia. You know, China is gradually coming back up to production. Some of the Southeast Asian countries have suffered less than others, for example, Vietnam. Europe is starting to open up a little bit, as is the Middle East. Some countries and some continents are lagging a little bit behind. So you know, it is not a uniform situation across the world. And of course, we have to bear in mind that one thing is, you know, domestic travel and domestic trade, and the rest is international. So I think as long as there will be restrictions of international travel and people will not be able to meet face-to-face, which is very important, particularly for example, interviews at a senior level for the final decision, that slowdown will continue. I think as soon as there is a gradual release and we can get back to some level of international travel, you know, I can see certain businesses or certain sectors accelerating. I think supply chain, consumer related businesses, retail will be some of the first to react. The airlines are gradually announcing potential for scheduled flights, so not just repatriation flights, but scheduled flights from July. So you know, I'm hoping that by Q4, Q3 will probably be, you know, still maybe not under restrictions, but slower. But I would like to see, or I would hope to see Q4 emerge stronger. In the sectors that are very hit today, for example, such as travel and hospitality, I predict that first of all, the domestic travel and domestic tourism will emerge before the international one.
Well, Michael, thank you for sharing your views with us.
Thank you. It's been a pleasure, Vikram.